terms of markets, this is the last unit of your microeconomics, right? Moving on to the topic, first of all, we shall understand the meaning of the term market, what a market means. Many of you would define a market as a place where the goods are sold or where the services are sold, right? But technically, market is a system. Don't call it a place. Obviously, a place is required for a market to be established, but market is necessarily a system which brings potential buyers and potential sellers into close contact for purchase or sale of a commodity. A commodity may be a good or a service, right? See, all these words which I have written, they symbolize the characteristic of a market. First of all, it is a system by which potential buyer. Potential means having the ability. Anybody having the ability to buy, and potential seller, anybody having the ability to sell, come into close contact in order to sell or purchase the commodity. So when you have to define the market, you can define it as simply as a system which brings buyer and potential seller into close contact to buy or sell a commodity. Then when we talk about buyer and seller, okay, these are the two most important components of any market, and obviously the commodity for which they are dealing. Now, after understanding the meaning of the market, like for example, this market can be created even sitting at home, okay, online shopping. Even some of you watching this video online, okay, so this is also a market. A service is being sold and a service is being bought. Now we come to the discussion of the forms of market. Form simply means the types or the structures of the market. How many types of market are there? See, when we are comparing the market structures, there are certain characteristics on which we compare them. Like for example, if I have to compare two students, suppose student A and student B, I can compare them on various parameters, like for say example academic, their performance in the academics, sports, behavior, discipline. Okay, so some characteristics might be there, might not be there. Okay, like this, I can compare two students. Similarly, for comparing two markets, I have certain, these are the parameters or characteristics on which, on the basis of which I am comparing two students. Now, similarly, the markets can also be compared on the basis of certain parameters. To understand the forms of market in a better way, you first need to know that what are the parameters on which the market can be differentiated. Parameters to compare the markets, or these are the characteristics which may be different in different forms of market. First is the number of buyers and sellers. Means when you are looking at the any market, you have to look for the number of buyers and sellers, then the type of product, then entry and exit, control over price, knowledge about the market. Okay, so it means that these are the basic characteristics, basic parameters on the basis of which I can differentiate between various given markets. Number of buyers, can simply understand what it means, type of the product which they are offering, then entry and exit, is it possible in that particular market, control over the price, and knowledge about the market. Now, on the basis of these, we will discuss the various forms of market. There are four forms of market that we have to study, or we can say there are four types of market that we have to study. First is perfect competition or perfect market. Second is monopoly. Third is monopolistic. And fourth is oligopoly. Okay, these are the various market structures that we have to study. There is one more market structure, monopsony, and maybe some of the books have the discussion about monopsony also. We'll discuss that also. Now we'll compare all these markets on the basis of the same parameters: number of buyers, type of product, knowledge, okay, entry, exit. First we'll move on to the perfect market. And we also have to remember that when we are discussing a particular feature, the feature is no doubt important, but more important is its implication, right? We'll discuss in detail what implication means. Simply you can understand implication is a result or outcome of that particular feature, or the presence of that particular feature gives what characteristic to the market. First of all, we'll talk about the basic meaning of the perfect competition or perfect market. See, perfect market is a market structure characterized by large number of sellers and buyers, selling homogeneous products with no degree of control over price. Or we can call it as price taker. These are the important words that the definition of perfect market contains. Or you can simply say that this is the structure of the perfect market, where there are large number of buyers and sellers selling homogeneous goods. We'll talk about it in detail what are homogeneous goods, with no degree of control over the price, or they are also called as price taker firms. Okay, here firm, individual firm, doesn't have any control over the price. And you must understand the two terms, industry and firm. See, industry is a group of firms. Means all the firms added together form an industry, right? Suppose you say automobile industry, so all the firms like Maruti, Hyundai, Honda, Mahindra, whatever firms are producing car, automobiles in your economy, they all will be totaled up, and that will be the automobile industry. So here individual seller or individual firm has no control over the price. The industry will decide the price as a whole. Every firm has to follow the same price. That is why they are known as the price taker. If you want to define it, you will define it as it is a market structure where there are large number of buyers and sellers selling homogeneous goods with no degree of control over price, or they are the price takers. Now we will study the features of the perfect market, and remember, more than the feature, its implication is important. And the features will now again be based on the same parameters. Features of perfect market, or you can call it as perfect competition, even no issues in the two words. The first feature is large number of sellers and buyers. See, here we are talking about the buyer also, but in the later markets we will talk only from the point of view of the sellers. Here they are infinite sellers and infinite buyers. Simply means that there are, say, suppose 100 crore firms in an industry all together, large number, infinite. Similarly, infinite buyers, or you can say demand is perfectly elastic. Now see, if you talk about one firm individually, its share is the share of individual firm is almost negligible. Negligible means almost zero. Doesn't have any control over the market because there are large number of firms, too many firms. So what happens? This firm is simply a price taker. Say out of this, say 10, 1 lakh or 10 lakh people say we will not open the shop, we want the price to be increased. doesn't affect the market, right? Nobody has control over the price or over the supply. So that's why we call, say that implication of this feature in the perfect competition is that firm is a price taker. Firm cannot influence the price of the commodity. You may be asked the to explain the implication of this particular feature. So, and remember the question will be based on the implication and not directly on the feature. Means you will never be asked that explain the large number of buyer and seller function of the feature of the perfect competition. You will be asked that what is the implication of large number of buyer and seller under the perfect competition, right? So the implication is that individually the firm is a price taker, it cannot influence the price of the commodity because its share in the market is almost negligible, almost zero. But it can sell any amount at the given price. Why? Because buyers are also infinite, perfectly elastic demand. As there are too many sellers, similarly there are too many buyers. So in the implication you need to mention both the things, that the firm will be a price taker due to the negligible share and also it can sell any amount at the given price, right? So if we draw the demand curve of this particular market, you also need to draw the curve which shows you the perfectly elastic demand. And remember, we have already done that. We had already done that the demand curve and the marginal revenue curve and the price line, they all are same in the perfect competition, right? So this is the sales of the, see, suppose the price is 10, the firm produces say 100 units, they will be sold. Next day it produces, we can simply see that the firm can sell any amount of output, but the condition is that the price remains the same. So this is how you have to understand each and every feature, right? The meaning of the feature and most important its implication. Question will be directly based on the implications. Second is homogeneous goods. See, again remember the parameters. First we studied the number of buyer and sellers. Second is the type of product or the type of commodity. So here the sellers are selling homogeneous goods. Homogeneous means identical in all respects. All the characteristics of the product are same. For example, we all use a pen. They are all close substitutes of one another. But the same model of a pen, written the same words, that will be a perfect substitute, absolutely identical. Or you can simply say that they should be alike in shape, size, color, odor, any other characteristic, they should be alike. You can't even differentiate, like you can call them as identical twins. You cannot even differentiate that which product was given to you first and which was given to you second. See what happens due to the homogeneous, or one important thing, we call them as perfect substitutes. They can also be called as perfect substitutes. Like if you have two models of the same pen, right? Then you have the perfect substitute, absolutely identical, but others are all close substitutes. So what happens, because the seller is offering a homogeneous product at the same price, the implication or the result is that buyer is indifferent among sellers. Remember this word indifferent, we have already done it in the consumer equilibrium. Indifferent means doesn't differentiate between the sellers. Or you can, in simple words, say that the buyer can buy from any seller. Right, so if you ask this particular explanation or implication of this feature, first you will write what are homogeneous goods, they are perfect substitutes, or you can, or they are identical in shape, size, color, order, etc. And the implication, the result is that the buyer is indifferent among the sellers because he gets the same product from all the sellers. So he and at the same price. So he can buy from any seller. Then third is perfect knowledge. The third we can do first, free entry and exit. Free entry and exit means that any new firm can enter the market at any point of time. Similarly, an existing firm can withdraw from the market at any point of time. There is no restriction on entry and exit. Now, the implication of this feature is only normal profit in the long run. We already know the meaning of normal profit. It means when PR is equal to PC or mathematically the profit is zero, right? But you know that it already contains the profit of the entrepreneur. When we were doing cost, we had already seen that the total cost already includes the profit of the entrepreneur. So in economics, normal profit is always when total revenue is equal to total cost or profit is equal to zero. Why does this happen? See, whenever suppose there is some profit in the short run, any supernormal profit where TR is more than TC, what happens? New firms enter. Right? When the new firms will enter, then supply will rise. And you know when supply rises, price starts falling. So prices start falling and this profit is again neutralized, or you can say it again becomes zero. So when you are explaining, you have to mention that if there is any profit in the short run, some few new firms will enter the market due to free entry and exit, which will lead to rise in the supply of the product in the market and fall in the prices, which again neutralizes the profit to zero. Similarly, if there is any loss in the short run, some firms will leave the market, which will lead to decline in supply, leading to rise in price, and again the loss being neutralized to zero. Right? This is the whole thing that you have to explain if you are asked the implication of the third feature, that is free entry and exit. All these words to be mentioned, right? First, the meaning of normal profit, then you will explain that if there is any profit in the short run, new firms enter, supply rises, prices fall, profit neutralizes to zero, and vice versa for the loss. Then the next feature is perfect knowledge. See, perfect knowledge means that you know each and every aspect about the particular commodity. Perfect knowledge cannot be found in the practical life, like you may not have, or rather you will not have any perfect knowledge regarding any product which you are using. You can think over it and realize that you use a refrigerator, a television, a mobile phone, but do you have perfect knowledge about it? You do not have. How it has been made, what technique has been used, what type of components have been used, right? Or what is the cost of production of that commodity. But here in the perfect competition, there is perfect knowledge with the buyer as well as with the seller. See, buyer has the complete knowledge regarding the product market. Product market is the market where products are being sold, final goods are being sold. And seller has the complete knowledge regarding the factor market. Factor market means where the factors of product production are being bought and sold, because seller needs to go to the factor market while the buyer needs to go to the product market. So when the buyer has complete knowledge about the characteristics of the product, about the price of the product, the implication is that no seller can charge a higher price. Okay, so here we will have two implications, one from the point of view of, from the point of view of the buyer and one from the point of view of the seller. From the point of view of the buyer, no seller can charge a higher price for him, or you can say no buyer is willing to take a give a higher price for the commodity. From the point of view of the seller, we can understand it on the basis of the term known as competitive advantage. Okay, it is a simple term to understand. Competitive advantage is simply advantage of one firm over the other. Like for example, if you talk about say Reliance launched its milk, and similarly a local brand say Uttaranchal Milk launched its milk in the market. So without having any much knowledge about the market, I can say that it will be easier for the Reliance company to sell its milk as compared to the other company, that is the Uttaranchal Milk, because the Reliance has a huge amount of goodwill, or you can say it is a brand name already established, such a big brand name. It has huge capital with it, huge amount of money, it can advertise. So, but this is a new firm. Okay, doesn't have this much of resources, right? So this is the advantage of Reliance over the Uttaranchal Milk. This is known as competitive advantage. So in perfect competition, the perfect knowledge of the seller implies that no seller has competitive advantage over others. The implication is that no firm has competitive edge over the other, or you can call it as competitive advantage. So if this particular feature is asked, the implication is asked, you explain it from the point of view of the buyer as well as from the point of view of the seller. Okay, then next feature is independent decision making. It simply implies independent decision making that firm is not depending on the other firm to take any decision, or you can say decision of one firm will not affect the other firms. It implies that the firm can take the decisions regarding the output and production on its own. Remember, production, not the price. Okay, price is decided by the industry. Except the price, all the decision can be taken by the firm. Right? Entry, exit, everything. Firm is having all the rights to take the decision, and decision of one firm will not affect the other firm due to huge number of firms. The next feature is perfect mobility among factors. This is a sort of assumptions because practically it is not true. Okay, factors, we understand, we are talking about the factors of production. We have to first understand the, now understand the meaning of these two terms, perfect and mobility. Mobility, you can simply understand movement, ability to move, or you can say shift. Though in demand and supply, movement and shift are different words, but obviously they move, mean the same, moving from one place to another, shifting from one place to another. And perfect means without, while perfect means without loss of efficiency, it means that say for example a person A is working as a carpenter. Now he is made to work as a plumber. Next day he is made to work as a say electrician. so he can perform all the jobs with equal efficiency. Means he will be a good carpenter, he will be a good plumber, and he will be a good electrician, and so on. Right? This means this is meant by perfect mobility among the factors. It means that if a factor of production is being used at one particular place, it can be used in some other place with same efficiency. Or you can say, suppose today I am teaching economics, then tomorrow I teach you chemistry, then I teach you biology, then I teach you physics, math, all with the equal efficiency. But practically it is not possible. So it is just the assumption of the perfect competition. And its implication is, you can simply see the implication that skills can be learned easily. Skills can be learned easily. It is very easy to acquire the skills for the factors of production or for the labor. Okay, so if this particular feature is asked, then you will explain the meaning of this perfect mobility, and you will also explain that its implication is to that the skills can be learned easily, but practically it is not possible. Okay, then the last feature is no transportation cost. No transportation or even selling cost. Selling is the cost of promoting the product, like for advertisement, for the salesman salary or commission of the agents for promoting your particular product, right? And transportation, you understand, transporting the commodity from one place to another. It is based on the assumption that products are made and sold locally. Means they are sold at the point where they are being produced. From the firm or the factory itself they are sold. No need to transport the commodities. Again, practically not possible. And the selling cost is not there, or you can say the advertisement cost is not there, because there will be no use of the advertisement. Okay, whatever cost you will incur on advertisement, that will be waste, because buyer cannot be induced to buy your commodity. He has perfect knowledge about the product and he knows that every seller is selling the same commodity. So no use of the advertisements. So these all characteristics are of the perfect competition, and when you go through them, you realize that most of them are practically not possible. Like homogeneous products, practically not possible. Free entry and exit, practically not possible. Talk about no transportation cost, not possible. Talk about perfect mobility, not possible. So here, most of the characteristics being impractical, or the perfect market itself is impractical. In real life, you cannot visit a perfect market, right? But it is simply perfect here symbolizes that it is a perfect model of a market. A market should be like this. Neither the buyer is having any advantage nor the seller is having any advantage, right? So most of the theories that we study, they are based on the perfect competition in economics. Now we shall take our discussion to the second form of market, which is just the opposite of the perfect competition or the perfect market. It is the monopoly market or monopoly competition. Again, to understand this, we can simply break the two words into two. Mono means single and poly means seller. Okay, so the name itself suggests single seller. It is a market structure where there is a single seller selling the product which has no close substitutes, with full control over price, or you can call him as the price maker. He is the decider of the price for his commodity. So when you are defining monopoly competition, we will define it as, it is a market structure where there is a single seller selling a product which has no close substitutes, with full control over the price or full degree of control over the price, or is also known as the price maker. So just opposite of the perfect competition. So now we'll study the features of monopoly market or the monopoly competition. First and foremost is the single seller. So as the name says, single seller, there is only one seller of that particular commodity. Like for example, you can take the Indian Railway or Electricity Supply Board, where there is single supplier of the commodity. Like if you talk about a little, say 10 or 15 years back, Johnson & Johnson was having monopoly in the baby products. Similarly, for certain period of time, IBM or Microsoft had the monopolies over their certain products, right? So single seller, what it implies is complete control over price. Or you can say complete control over the output. He can influence the output and price of the commodity. Or the terminology used is price maker. The firm is a price maker and the firm is an industry itself. Okay, because there is only one firm. So here you cannot differentiate between industry and a firm. So if this is asked, the implication is complete control over the price. For the second feature, even we have the same implication. The second feature is no close substitute. Means the product which the monopoly is offering doesn't have any close substitute. For example, for the railway, there is no close substitute. Either you have the airways or you have the roadways. They are different from the railway. Close substitute would mean that they are almost similar. Again, implication remains the same. Full control over price, or in short, I can write it simply as a price maker. And same explanation, that he can control the output of the commodity. So completely the price is under the control of the monopoly. Then third important feature which gives rise to the monopoly, that is restricted entry. Remember, a market can remain monopoly only when this feature is present, restricted entry. It means no other firm can enter the market, because as soon as any other firm enters the market, it will not remain as monopoly. The restricted entry may be due to, or this question can be even framed as, the causes of monopoly, or it can also be framed in the form of why is there a single seller under monopoly. Okay, so individually also this question can be put up, what are the causes of monopoly, or why is there a single seller in the monopoly, or explain restricted entry under a monopoly. So we will now understand the causes of restricted entry, why the entry is restricted under monopoly, or how can the entry under monopoly be restricted. The first is the law of land. Law of land means the government rule, like, or you can simply call it as government legislation, where the government has made a rule that no other firm can enter. Example, the Indian Railway. Like if many of you may be aware that even the Ambanis wanted to start railway service in India, but they were denied by the government because government wanted to keep the railway under its own monopoly. Second is patent right. Patent right, we have to first understand what a patent right is. Simply, if you innovate something or you invent something, then you can get it patented. Like when you see the books, there it is written copyright reserved, or you see a CD of a movie, you often find that the rights reserved. It means that you cannot copy it. So patent right is an exclusive right which allows a firm or the innovator or the inventor that his technique, his technology or his process cannot be copied by any other firm. For example, remember this word, Xerox. Okay, many times you call Xerox as a photocopy. You get a Xerox of this. But actually Xerox was the company which first time made the photocopier. and it attained the patent from the government. Once it got the patent, then this technology of making this machine cannot be copied. So what happens? Till the time there is patent life, till that time this firm will remain as monopoly, right? But always you have to remember that a patent has a life, and after some time it is ended. It is ended because if I give a patent forever, then that commodity cannot improve. Like for example, when this Xerox invented the machine, its price was around 1 lakh. And size was also very big. If you might have seen an old photocopier at some of the shops. But now I can get a printer, scanner, photocopier all in one at about 3000, and there are so many companies making it. So modern techniques can be used or can be invented only when the patent right is removed. But to give the advantage to the innovator or to encourage innovation in an economy, the government has given this right of patent. So if it is asked, you can explain the meaning of patent. It is a right which forbids all other firms to copy a particular technique. And I have also explained you the meaning in detail, right? You should know what a patent means. It's a general thing. Then third is formation of cartels. Cartel is another technical term, which means when two firms join to act as single firm. Suppose there were say three firms in a market, A, B and C. They all join and form a single firm, ABC Limited. Okay, so it again creates a monopoly. Cartel is a general agreement between firms to act as a single firm. Then next is control over resources. Means that the inputs required in that particular production process are owned by a particular firm. Like for example, the ONGC. Okay, it has the control over most of the oil rigs in India. So it is a monopoly for the petroleum. Then next could be technical know-how. Technical know-how is the knowledge of doing that, producing that particular product or following a certain process. No other firm knows how to do that particular type of production or is not aware of the technique of production. Then last could be huge capital requirement. Means a huge amount of money is needed. Like for example, for a nuclear power plant, huge amount of money is required, which cannot be invested by most of the firms. So these are all the causes of the restricted entry, and they are also the causes for the formation of a monopoly. If you are asked this, you can explain any of these as the causes of monopoly. And remember, this question individually can be put forth in front of you, that why is the restricted entry in monopoly, or what are the causes of monopoly. Then the next another important feature of the monopoly is price discrimination. Okay, it is an exclusive feature of monopoly. Price discrimination. Exclusive means not found in any other form of market. Okay, only possible under the monopoly. Price, we already know what it means. Discrimination means differentiating. Or you can say charging a different price for the same product from different consumers. Okay, where the firm is charging a different price for the same product from different buyers. For example, railway. Okay, charges less money from children, from senior citizens, from the below poverty lines. Okay, and charges more money from the other classes, for the general classes. So this is possible only when it is a monopoly form of market, because if it is followed in any other form of market, then only these people will buy from you, others will buy from some other seller. But here it is possible because the buyer has no other choice to go, he has only a single seller of that particular product in the market. So this is an important feature. Many times it is asked in the monopoly market, you have to explain what product differentiation, what price discrimination means, and why is it possible only under monopoly. Then the next feature of monopoly market is price maker with constraint. Or I can say downward sloping AR and MR. See, when we look at these terms, price maker with constraint, first of all, price maker we already know, we can decide the price. Constraint means a limitation, a hurdle. Okay, though I can fix the price of my commodity, but there is some limitation to it, because if I charge a very high price, then the buyers will not buy my commodity. For example, if railway charges a very high price, then what will the travelers do? They'll either go by bus if they are poor, if they are rich enough, they can afford, they'll go by the flight. So this is the limitation. And simply you apply the law of demand. If the price is very high, then demand for the product will be low. And if the price of the commodity is low, then the demand would be high. Or you can say that the sales will fall if he charge a very high price. The buyers may choose to go without the consumption of that product. Or the result is that the AR and MR are downward sloping. Right? On the x-axis I have the output. On the y-axis we have AR and MR, and you know AR is the price and the demand curve of the firm. So a downward sloping demand curve, or you can call it as downward sloping AR and MR. We can simply see that suppose if I keep the price of my commodity say as 10, I am able to sell 1000 units. If I increase the price to say 12, then lesser units, maybe say 800 units, right? So sales can be increased by reducing the price, and remember it is part of the imperfect competition, right? We have also done it when we were doing the chapter of revenue. So if you are asked this, to explain this, you will write the meaning, you will make the diagram, and you will also mention that here the limitation is that if the price is fixed too high, then the buyer may go even without the consumption of that product, right? Or sales can be increased by reducing the price. And then the last feature of the monopoly market is no selling cost.